Hey, this is Fallout Plays, and you're listening to REZOcast. Hey everybody, this is Lego. Welcome to REZOcast episode 16. We've got Hove and Triton and a special guest, Fallout. Welcome to the show. We're so excited to have you here, man.
Thanks so much for having me here.
Yeah, for sure. This week, man, I hate to say it, but I have played more PvE than PvP this week, and it feels so weird. Like, I don't know, out of the blue, I've just like been hitting up a bunch of strikes, nightfalls. I guess I'm grinding for that icebreaker, you know, and some of the Zavala bounties and stuff. Hove, how's your week been, man?
Pretty much the same. I still can't bring myself to care about the icebreaker, but it is like the third week in a row that I was excited to play PvE, which hasn't happened since like the Taken King. So strike scoring has been a lot of fun for me. I really enjoyed that. And yeah, other than that, it's been the reverse for me of what it usually is. PvE over PvP. Triton, what have you been up to?
Well, I did manage to get into Trials when it opened on Friday with a couple of our clan mates, so, you know, that was fun and just kind of something. I usually don't get into Trials on Friday. I usually wait till Monday or, you know, wait till Hove invites me in via a stream and I don't accept, so I usually don't do Trials. But I've been helping people try to get Icebreaker, actually, just because I feel like I got it on the very first nightfall I did, and that's, wow. As you guys know, that's what I thought. I thought you just only had to do it one time.
Oh my god!
So I've been trying to pawn off that RNG luck onto everybody else, and successfully did that for a couple people the other day. So.
And you like to mention that all the time.
I do, because I like to make sure that you know that, Hove.
So wow, that's so funny. You got it on the first try?
First try, and I thought that that's all you had to do, because I was like, oh, sweet, so Icebreaker. Funny. Did you guys get that too? Was that a quest? And they're like, no.
Oh my god.
I was like, oh. And I think I got the ornament like right away for it as well, so it was pretty awesome.
Which one did you get though?
I got the camo one, and then recently I got whatever like the
other
one.
Oh, you got both
of
them already?
So I think I have them both now. Gosh. I have them both now. Just so you know, Hove, I'll text you later too that I have them both as well.
I couldn't care any less.
Oh well, we'll see about that. I'll text you at 3 a.m. You'll care.
Anyway, Fallout, how about you? Anything exciting going on this week for you?
Exciting? Oh, I don't know about that, man. Just diving into PvP like I always do. I mean, I did actually get to play Trials right from the get-go on Friday.
Nice.
Because I had off work, which was really cool. Usually I work on Friday.
Me too, yeah.
Adult life, am I right?
I hate being
an
adult.
It sucks, dude.
I did get to run a Trials run too at the beginning of the week, and I feel like it's the one thing every week in Destiny that I'm like super looking forward to that keeps me like coming back. And I just made like I just thought about it this week again because I had been playing so much Battlefield 1 and Titanfall 2 the week before, just trying to get through those stories, and coming back to Destiny and playing Trials, it was like, man, there's nothing else in any other game that presents like a competitive multiplayer experience in that format, you know, that has something like has stakes on it, you know, and it takes a long time to get there too. And I don't know, it just like pumps me up every single time. I'm like cheering my teammate on, like, oh, he's around the corner, whether I'm doing call outs or like see him go on a 1v3, and you're like, yes, dude, you did it, you know, like jumping out of my seat like, I can't believe you got it, you know.
Trials is one of the most unique things I've seen in any video game. I love that it's in Destiny, and it was probably one of the greatest things Bungie ever put in the game. It's not even my favorite thing to play in Destiny by like a long shot, but it's so awesome for the community.
Yeah, totally agree.
Yeah, you're right. And it's like you said, Lego, it's the only thing that brings you those stakes and the build up and everything that way. And that's why I know how much you like 1v3, so that's why when I play with you, I die, and I let you do the 1v3s. Oh. That's how that works. I just want you to know, I do that for you.
Oh, that's what everybody says now. Everybody says, as soon as they die, they're like, oh, you wanted this, right, Lego? You wanted this experience, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. Just being a good friend.
Wow, that's a true friend. He's like a wingman.
Yeah, right? Ruining my KD one match at a time for Lego.
It's for a good cause. For a good cause.
Yeah.
Well, Fallout, we do want to get to know you here a little bit for those who don't know you, which I don't know how they wouldn't, because I was just thinking about the list of things that you're involved in here. And before I list anything, I want to pose the question real quick. What do you feel like your place is in Destiny, and where do you feel like you fit in with the community or in the game? What's your niche, you know, if you will?
That's a good question, though. Everybody calls me the scientist. A lot of people come to me for questions about PvP mechanics or just anything related to a subclass or a weapon. And that, there's a lot of great people out there in the community that do that.
Mm-hmm.
But just, it means a lot to me that so many people just randomly reach out to me.
Yeah.
I mean, War Bulletproof, I don't know if you know War Bulletproof, fantastic mm-hmm. tournament player. He just randomly reached out to me to ask about the recent tweaks that they had made to sweat yeah. settings to try and replicate a year one environment. He was like, Paula, can you test this? I was like, this is awesome. War Bulletproof talks to me. But yeah, many things I do. I just like to help the community. That's what I like to do.
Yeah, and so it's just whatever form that that takes at the time, basically.
Yeah, it's usually in a PvP realm. You know, people come at me, what's the best perk for this gun? Or like, how do you run your subclass? What do you do on this map? Et cetera, et cetera. I just love to help people improve and get better. It's why I do trials carries. It's why I do guides on YouTube. It's why I do everything that I do.
Yeah. So. Well, here, let me list off some of the things that I was thinking of, just to put it into perspective for those who don't know you that well, or just so the people who do know you can actually think about this too, because it was kind of mind-blowing for me. I was like, okay, he's, you know, the Crucible scientist, math and facts guy, you know, he's Crucible advice guy. He is such a personality in the sweat community. He's known for, you know, his play to win attitude, known for shoutcasting tournaments, voice on Planet Destiny, and help write standard Destiny tournament rules that are in place now, and so along with the rest of the community. But it's just like so many aspects of the Destiny community you're involved in, and I was like, dang, that is crazy, you know, to get to that point. But it's awesome though, because to hear why you do it, like straight up from the get-go, like it's just to help other people, and that's what you love doing. You saw that need and you started filling it.
Man, hearing it all listed off like that, it makes me like want to take a nap.
Yeah,
it makes me want to take a nap. Yeah, I don't even do any of
fit all that in. Yeah, you should take it. You deserve a nap.
One day.
But that is one of the reasons, though, that we wanted to have you on. You're our first outside of Resolute guest that we've had on the podcast since we started the show. And it's because, like, anytime you post a Crucible video that is, you know, doing your scientist gig, it's being posted in Resolute's personal group me, you know, that just we share with each other. And we're like, oh, did you see this new video by Fallout? Like, he said that this perk is actually better than that one. And then we have our own conversation internally about it. And it's like, man, like, I want to have this guy on who, like, he is such an influence of the community that we're talking about him within our own, like, clan's own conversations, you know? And so it's just an honor to have you here, man. We're pumped to have you here, and we're really excited.
Yeah. I don't know what this, that's so, like, that makes me really happy, man. I'm really honored to, I didn't know I was the first outside guy that you brought in on the podcast. That's so cool. Really, thank you so much for having me.
We're pumped, man. We're excited. And just to keep the conversation going, just about all those things and all the different things you do, I was curious, what is there a type of content that you prefer making that you feel like really fills you up? Because you are known as the Crucible Scientist, but also a podcaster, also shoutcasting, you know, all these other things, known in the sweat community. Is there a part that, like, is like, man, I feel like this is really my jam, even though, you know, I'm known for all these things, either, like, you feel really comfortable doing or you just really enjoy doing, you know, and why?
Totally. I really love the deep YouTube guides that I do. I mean, sometimes I do really short guides, like, oh yeah, warlock surfing, you know, here's how you warlock surf. Or
I just watched that like an hour ago. True story.
But then there's like the subclass guides, the really deep ones, and the testing I do on armor levels, the really in-depth nitty-gritty number stuff. I love
the nerdy stuff.
It takes the nerdy stuff. It takes so long to do, truly.
Mm-hmm.
But when I first put out those subclass guides, just felt like really like the king of the world, even though I couldn't compare to, you know, huge Destiny personalities like, you know, Datto or whatever. But I still felt that, I don't want to say void, but it just made me feel good, you know, because, you know, I was really getting my hands in the dough, and some people are like, wow, this has never been done to that level of detail before. And even though it just took so... I'm going to keep telling you how long it took to make.
Because it took that long.
It took a long time. But yeah, it's just super rewarding to be like the first guy to figure out exactly how the mechanics of electrostatic mind worked on the Stormcaller and stuff like that. It's just really cool stuff.
Well, speaking of Datto, even though, you know, I know you just mentioned him specifically as, you know, you don't compare yourself to him as a big personality and everything, the one thing that I've realized as we talk about a lot of the things you do, do you think it'd be fair to say that you're kind of, to PvP, what Datto does for PvE with a lot of the in-depth guides and the numbers analysis and that kind of stuff?
Sure, yeah. And like 1% of his fan base size? Yeah, I'd be like the PvP Datto guy, I would say.
That's what I think that's
a fair comparison. Yeah.
Like, whenever I think, because I feel like the community thinks that too, even if the following isn't like obviously as big, like I think the community as a whole, whenever they think like, okay, if I want to know how much damage my Black Spindle is going to put out on this particular raid boss, I'm going to search a Datto video. But if I want to know what the max range of a rangefinder is and what perks are going to get me that farthest one hit kill, I'm gonna look at Fallout, you know. And I feel like the community knows that and they search that out, and I definitely do. Like, it's, and the one that sticks out to me the most was like the it was the RAM testing, like way back when, and just the particulars of what can kill it, and you give such good examples too, like, well, with the thorn and the headshots, it's like this, but, and so you use the most popular weapons at the time or whatever, so it's easy to relate to, you know, so it's like really easy advice to digest and then go and put it into action afterwards.
Thanks for pointing that out. That's actually something I really try to do when I make YouTube content, is that I've seen a tremendous amount of very helpful YouTube guides by some very smart people in this community. Some of them, unfortunately, not really recognized because they're just, you know, YouTube people trying to make it on their own. They're doing it for the hobby or what have you. And God love them. But I've seen some fantastic videos, but some of them were just really overcomplicated. And I actually went to college years ago. I'm so much older than you think I am. I went to college for film production and editing.
Oh, nice.
So when I saw these awesome guides on YouTube, I was like, wow, this is just so fantastic. But it's like, it's kind of really long and it's hard to die. I had to like rewatch a couple times. Like, what the hell did that mean? Like, what the fuck are you talking about with this number? And then I was just like, it would just be so much easier if there was a way to just give people really important PvP or any kind of information that they needed, but give it to them in a really easy to, like, there's no confusion. Here's what you need. Here's what you don't need. Go out, make it happen. Easy to understand.
I knew there was something about you, and now I figured out what it is. It's that, you know, you went to school for film production, and I'm a wedding videographer as one of my jobs, and so it's like, oh, there, it's so clean, you know, and it's so well made. And okay, it's making sense to me now.
I'm glad.
But no, it is very evident that it's clear, though.
So Fallout, you kind of mentioned earlier on, you know, when Lego had talked about some of your videos, you know, you take a lot of pride in being, you know, first to flesh out something. You know, you talk a little bit when you opened about how so many people are doing content. And when you think about, you know, your niche, when you think about all the different hats that kind of Lego listed off for you, you know, where are you finding the motivation and kind of the content in a down period to apply your skills to something that hasn't been done per se, and, you know, something that people are going to care about at this point in the game?
That's a really good question. We are definitely in a wee bit of a content lull right now.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people are frustrated by how that affects the community in terms of content, in terms of, you know, entertaining and getting things done. I just am going to make the content that I think people need to see or people want to see. Sometimes I'll put out a tweet, hey, what do you guys want to see? What interests you? Sometimes people will hit me with really easy questions. Like, I can answer that right away on Twitter. It's like, oh, what do I want on my palindrome? Like, this is what you want. That's why you want it. But other people, like the Warlock Surfing Guide, some people are like, I don't.
Yes.
Like, I just, can you just teach? Because, Fallout, you play Warlock all the time. I don't really know how to move as fast as a lot of these really good players. How do you do it? It's like, okay, fine. So it definitely is kind of tragic when we hit these points in the Destiny timeline where we're kind of like waiting for Destiny 2 to come out or any news on the sequel. But fortunately, the community is so awesome and they're just always interested in this super crazy cool game that we have, even if the viewership goes down a little bit in between expansions or what have you. I'm just gonna make the content that I think the people want.
Well, speaking of this amazing game that we have, how, just out of curiosity's sake, how did you get to Destiny? What drew you into this game to begin with? You're saying how awesome it is, you know, and it's funny because asking this question, I'm already thinking of how I know you play some Super Smash and I know you're into Pokemon, and I could talk to you about those games all night long, but I'm going to restrain myself and just ask, you know, just put it out there, you know, like what is it that drew you to Destiny?
I hope that this answer is not something that you've heard a million times before, but I'm pretty much guaranteeing it's something you've heard a million times before. I used to love Halo. That was such a fun game. I was a Halo kid. Loved that game, man. I used to play it when I was in high school, and then I played it in college. I was just playing that game all the damn time. It was so good.
Oh, yeah. So good. Just, and that gunplay draws you in, too, from Halo. God. Like, it's so easy to transition from that.
Oh, yeah. It was just so much fun. And Halo had a fantastic campaign, don't get me wrong, but the multiplayer was just so addicting. And I would stay up so late playing with my friends, and then I got really hooked, especially on Halo 2. Halo 2 multiplayer, I was watching MLG, the tournaments that they had on Major League Gaming all the time, every month. They're like, oh, MLG Vegas. It's like Final Boss versus, God, what was the team? Like Carbon or something. I can't remember all the team names from the MLG days. But I was like super, super into it. So played a ton of Halo PvP, and then forever time passed because there are, God, so many Halo games now.
Yeah.
And around whenever, what was the time? It was around at the end of Halo 4 or something, or at the end of Halo Reach.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Bungie was like, hey, we're doing our own thing now. We're making this cool game. It's called Destiny. You should probably keep your eye on it. And I went, yeah, I am definitely keeping my eye on that.
That is what I'm going to do. Yeah.
Because Bungie is the best ever. I'm just going to keep my eye on it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I'm here.
Yeah, it's funny. You would think that we would hear that more often, but you're like one of the first people to really outright say this is directly how aside from not even me, I guess, because I was like that in high school. I'm glad my wife isn't listening to this podcast because it's probably going to be too embarrassing for her. But like during my lunch breaks, I remember during Halo 2, I would play with one hand sniping people in Halo 2. Like I was that obsessed with playing online just to like get the skill down. You know, I would just be like eating with one hand and still playing because I was that obsessed with the multiplayer. It's ridiculous. And so like that's just, I did love Bungie, but it wasn't, I don't think I made the connection that a company who made this game is going to put just as much love into the next game, you know? And so I just never made that connection, moved through a couple of other games, and it was friends that were getting it, that were like, dude, you gotta come play this game. And as many know who have listened to this podcast, I ended up playing Destiny, and they ended up moving on and not getting super into it. So I'm the only one out of my physical friends around here that kept playing. Yeah. So, but it's just the way it goes. But yeah, I'm glad to have somebody else actually say, no, Halo directly influenced me like to get this game.
Which is why I started off on Xbox.
Okay, yeah. And you play Xbox a lot still.
I do. But I have both consoles now. The people who follow me on Twitch were really, really nice. We did a fundraiser, and they raised enough for me to get myself a PlayStation 4.
Oh, that's awesome.
Really
that's
cool. Awesome. Yeah, really nice of them. I'm followed by some fantastic people. And I'm still working on it. I only have a Warlock, but the Hunter is coming on PlayStation. Hunter's coming. It's been a really long time. I'm one of those people who overthink things a lot. Which is one of the reasons I love and hate Pokemon, because I love the strategy, but I'm just thinking about it so much. I'm like, Jesus, you just have to make a team. Like, you can't just stare at the piece of paper all night. You got to make a goddamn team. But yeah, so I knew I wanted the Warlock because I think the Warlock is fantastic in PvP. I don't think anyone's going to argue with that.
Yeah.
So I was just like, oh, Hunter or Titan? And I think it's going to be Hunter.
Good choice. Stay away from those Titans.
yeah. Gosh, dang it.
Titans are so good, though. Gosh.
They are. They're so. I'm glad you put out the Warlock skating guide, too, because like Warlock movement for me, just coming from a Titan, feels so drastically different. So I'm really excited to get into that video and
it's
really get it down.
Yeah, it's terrible. I actually hated the Warlocks in the beta. Can you believe that? When I played the Destiny beta, I was like, I am never playing a Warlock. These things are trash.
Oh my gosh.
Who would play this? Yeah, just because the movement was so terrible. Because it was the beta, you remember? Like, you didn't have enough time to upgrade the entire skill tree. So you could only get you get the basic glide. And I'm running around with a basic glide. I'm like, this is just such trash. Like,
I wonder how many people did that from the beta. It had to be quite a few that were like, I'm never playing that class. That is terrible.
Totally. Yeah.
I started as a warlock in the beta, and when I got the game, I went to a hunter and was like, oh, this is so much better.
Oh my
God. I didn't know. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I was just saying, I started off as a Titan. I thought that the jump was so good. I thought that the Titan had like no weakness. I was a Striker Titan, of course. And I was like, the jump is really good. It's smooth. You can go high. You can shut it off. You can turn it back on. And it's not shitty like the Warlock one. And you punch somebody and it feels good. And the Fist of Havoc, man, was just beast. It was just in the beta, at least.
It was the shoulder charge for me. The first time that Bungie released a video that showed a one-hit kill and how fast he was moving between opponents, I was like, forget everything else. I'm moving to Titan. I'm just going to wreck everyone.
But it was just so easy. Anytime someone ran up in my face in the beta, I was like, Fist of Havoc, done.
Yeah.
And it was just so good. I loved how after the beta, all my friends had drawn very clear lines in the sand. They're like, I'm a hunter, and fuck you if you don't play a hunter, man. And it was so funny, all these weird little class rivalries, and you joke with your friends. Oh, it was such a good time.
Yeah. It is fun to joke around like that, though, especially when, like, it's also fun to have that diversity in the game. And like when you have a team that's really diverse, the things that you can accomplish, like PvE or PvP, it's interesting. But, you know, I guess there is a reason that three of the same classes banned in sweats. So,
well, Fallout, I'm actually pretty glad you brought up Pokemon because, you know, for those who are subscribed to your channel, they know that you've been putting out Pokemon videos over the last couple of weeks. And one of the things I'm really curious about, because, you know, as you now know, you were the first non-Rezo member to be on the show here. Yes. And everyone that's been on the show that's a content creator, I've always known them through Twitch. Whereas for you, when Lego and Hove were like, hey, we want to get Fallout on the show, you know, I only know you from YouTube. Yeah. So as you're putting out these videos and as you're growing, I'm really curious to know, you know, has there been a struggle between putting out videos that you have a passion for as opposed to videos you think are going to sustain your content? And then, you know, furthermore, with that, have you found that your niche works differently or is more or less successful in different spaces besides FPS games?
First of all, that first question that you asked about, is there kind of like a disconnect between content you want to make, content you need to make to sustain your channel? Yes, 1,000% yes. Holy God, I can't say yes enough to that video. And I'm starting to realize more. I mean, I've been doing my channel for over a year now, or however long it's been. And I just keep learning more about the nature of YouTube and people who I used to be a salty guy, and they were just because I would put so much. I have a 9-to-5 job and I was putting so much time into these really in-depth guides, and a lot of people did watch them, which I was so thrilled about. I was just, could not be happier. But then, you know, my friend trying to egg me on or whatever, he would just link me to a subclass guide video of, I don't know, some YouTuber who's been doing it for like 10 years or something like that. You know, he's established, he's got a fan base, and the video was like 2 minutes long, and it's got no numbers or science in it. And he's just like, yeah, this is a good perk because I used it like one time. And he's got like a trillion views. And I was like, oh my God, what am I doing? And it's just like, I understand any kind of content that any YouTuber puts out, I understand. Because the YouTubers who do it for a living, you have to put out. It's the same thing with Twitch. If you want to be anyone listening to this podcast right now and you're thinking, hey, I want to make a YouTube channel or I want to start streaming on Twitch, the key to success is consistency. 100%.
Yeah.
If you really put your heart into it and you just do it every day and you keep doing it every day, you will see results. But when you're putting out, I mean, if I had the ability to and I could do YouTube full time, I totally would. I can't right now. But if I could, I would love to. And I would put out so much more content. But when you're putting out content at the rate I do, which is like maybe one, maybe two videos like a week, it just doesn't grow as fast. And some people just put out videos of, hey, you know, Bungie did a This Week at Bungie, and I'm just going to make a video of me talking about what happened this week at Bungie, and here's footage of me running around the tower talking about it. And I used to be a hater. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to pretend. I used to be a hater. It's like, oh, it's so low effort, et cetera, et cetera. And now I'm just like, this is their living. They do this for a living. Yeah. And they need to do this. It's like, so there's no shame. If you love making high content, high quality content, then do that. But you also need, I don't want to say low quality content, but you need to be putting out videos. You need to be entertaining your fan base. You got to be interacting. There's no such thing as bad content as long as your heart's behind it. And I think moving forward, I'm going to keep putting out content that is both high quality and maybe some shorter videos just to keep the momentum going. I actually put out a video on my channel the other day. I just thought it would be, I'm not even going to lie, I thought it would be hilarious to make a video entitled "Fuck It, I'm Going Back to Year One." I just thought that would be a funny title for a video. So I just recorded footage of me playing matchmaking with a year one loadout because I was like, oh, whatever happened to Sunsingers? They totally suck now. I'm going to use a Sunsinger. I'm whipping out Thorn. I'm using Viking Funeral and bringing it back. And I just did commentary over the PvP match that I thought was funny. And then I just took the best parts and I put it out. And it got way more views than I thought it would. So I was like, great, cool. So I can make good guides and I can also make entertaining videos just for people who like YouTube for the sake of entertainment. And there are so many of those people, and God love them. Yeah. So I'm going to do my best to give people content that they want, that they need, and to just entertain. So,
well, that video, I think everyone was just really excited to see you finally get that firebolt kill. It took a few tries, so but you finally got it. And the excitement was real.
Oh my gosh. I was just playing thinking to myself, did they really nerf the range? Because I used to play Sunsinger all the time. I mean, why not? They were a fantastic subclass, as much as people love to hate on them for being good. But I was just like, yeah, we're bringing it back. We're bringing it back. And I kept throwing them, and I was like, this is totally going to get the kill. Like, how did that not hit you? These T-Rex fireballs.
I blame the blueberries. I saw three or four times that it was like he was weak. You got him. You were like, yeah, there it is. And then you saw assist.
Yeah.
And, like, it even made me mad. I was like, you fucking blueberry. Like, that was my kill.
Oh, man. And in any other time, I'd be totally happy with that. I am, like, the least, like, oh, you stole my kill. Because, like, when I play, I sweat with my brother a lot.
Uh-huh.
And I love doing that. And when you're playing against people who are really, really good, like, not just matchmaking, pub stomping, you take every point that you can get. So my brother takes my kill, and I'm like, thanks, Bumpy, for taking my kill. 50 extra on the board. Let's go. Yeah. But then in this video, I'm just trying so hard to get a firebolt kill. And the blueberry comes in and punches the guy who I burned. I was like, oh, how dare you? How dare you?
Speaking of how difficult sweats are, I just was listening to Planet Destiny's last podcast, and you made a comment that was like, you know, your first time playing sweats, it's like, no, you will get destroyed. Like, you're,
oh, yeah.
And it just, I couldn't help but think, we've told this story before, but me and Hove did our first sweats, like, ever. I'm a big trials person. And so we did it for the first time, whenever that first Destiny tournament was going on. I think it was the first Farcog tournament. And so our friend Windler, Rezo, he was like, yeah, me, you, and Hove, and we'll grab somebody else, and we'll just come in here. And I was like, I made a fusion rifle. Like, I don't do this, you know? And he was like, ah, no, you know, it'll be cool. And so we all get in there, and he's like, hey, we're going to run a practice scrim, you know? And we're like, okay. And we're like, who is it? And he's like, oh, it's Lupo and Ramblin'. Like, it'll be fun. And we were like, oh, cool.
Yeah.
You know, and we get in there and just get demolished. Like, it was hilarious. And so it's our ongoing joke here. But you saying that on the podcast, so I was like, you have no idea, man. You have no idea how bad we got destroyed.
I love, for the record, I just want to say that Lupo and Ramblin' are just fantastic people. I'm sure everyone in the community knows that. And of course, they're both tremendously good. I'm not trying to say that, anyone listening to this, please don't twist my words on this, but I'm going to say that Ramblin' in particular is one of the most talented PvP players I've ever played with. He is phenomenal. He has everything because he has the ability to play every class well. I can play every class, but he can play every class tremendously well.
Yeah.
Right. He has skill with every gun type. He's like a strategist. He's really smart. He's just, he knows.
So what you're saying is he's kind of good at this game.
Don't even sub to me. sub to Ramblin', and he's phenomenal. And again, I'm not saying that Lupo isn't good, because Lupo's fantastic. Mm-hmm. But Ramblin' is like a Swiss Army knife. He's the best mm-hmm. Swiss Army knife ever. And I love the opportunities when I get to play with him. He's a busy guy. He streams all the time. But when I do get to play with him, I'm just like, yes, because I know I'm going to have the hardest game ever, because he's going to be everywhere. He's all over the map. He's
everywhere. Yeah. Yes.
You see him skate by. That,
yes.
you see him skate by 10 feet in the background, and you're like, oh, he's over there. And then all of a sudden, you know, he taps you on the back of your shoulder, and boom, shotgun, you're down.
With a shotgun. Everybody hopes to be in their, you know, Twitter highlight video they upload.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, you were saying earlier, you know, all the ways in which you were looking at other YouTubers and what they were doing. So basically what you were saying by that is you started making your own YouTube videos out of saltiness and frustration, right?
It was a mixture of things. I mean, I was looking for a creative outlet. I hadn't really... Because when you're in college and you major in something creative, you get all these opportunities to work on fun projects. And I was just really looking for that because, you know, you're at a job and it's not super creative. It pays the bills and you play a game that you love with your friends. And I was just like, yeah, man, I really want to do something. What could I do? And my friends were always asking me about what to do for whatever PvP game we play all together. It actually started when the Master Chief Collection was coming out for Xbox One, and a lot of people that I had played Halo with never played the earlier Halos, and they were like, yo, Fallout, do you got any tips? I've had it because I really want to play like Halo 1. I don't really know what to do. And I was like, why don't I just make a video? Because I know a lot about Halo 1. Why don't I just make a video?
That's cool.
Fill the need to do something creative. And I can help my friends get better in PvP. And I made a video. And I just shared it with my friends. And they're like, this is really good. You should put this on Reddit or something. And I was like, okay, fine. And then I put it on the Halo subreddit. And it just like exploded. And I was like, whoa, cool. I only expected to get like 20 views out of this from my friends. And I ended up getting multiple thousand. And they were like, you should keep doing stuff like this. You play Destiny a lot. You're really good at it. Why don't you do that? I was like, huh. Maybe I will.
That's really cool, man. That's good, man. Friends, like that's crazy. Like all that friends can bring, you know, whenever they're really pushing you to do something. I feel like that's how, like, I wouldn't have, I got the Movie of the Week emblem a little while ago, and I wouldn't have got that if, I think it was either Booker or Fury. One of them was like, hey, it was just one clip on Twitter that I was just messing around with some effects, and they were like, dude, that looks so cool. That could be a Movie of the Week clip right there. And I was like, really? And they're like, yeah, totally. And so I made a whole video of a whole bunch of that kind of stuff, and I was like, dang, like, and they just supported me through the whole thing. So friends, man, that is awesome.
Friends are the best.
For real.
If you don't have any, I suggest you go find some. Because they're awesome.
Triton.
Oh, me and your best friend. I don't know what you're talking about. But Fallout, as you're going over those things about Ramblin' and all the things he's able to do,
sure.
And as somebody who's been kind of motivated by putting out guides that people really can relate to, what do you feel is the biggest thing if there's a person who wants to focus on just one thing to improve in PvP? And on top of that, what do you think is the number one thing that most people put out that people are going to that really isn't helping them improve?
Man, these are some good 1-2 punch questions.
Yeah, Triton is the king of this.
Yeah, these Triton's kind of famous for not saying much, but then just has these profound questions that just rock your world.
The thing that you should be focusing on, is consistency and not limiting yourself by fear. Okay, so I know a lot of people who really want to get better at PvP, but they want to take shortcuts. And when I say take shortcuts, I mean like, oh well, let's just practice in matchmaking, or I don't really want to do trials. I don't want to, like, they're really good. Back out of this game, or something like that. And it's kind of tied into what I said on the Planet Destiny podcast, which is, look, the only way that you're really truly going to get better is if you push your limits. You have to put yourself outside of your comfort zone. And I know a lot of people don't like doing that, but putting yourself outside of your comfort zone is the best thing you can do for yourself if your goal is to improve. Because once you start dealing with the craziness, like, of the top level players and the top level metas and all that stuff, you start to learn, you start to adapt, and that's how grow as a person. It's that old saying, which I never remember who said it, but whatever it is, it's the hottest fires forge the toughest steel. And that's what people need to remember. So don't shy away from a challenge. And make sure that when you're doing all this stuff, if you have the means to, I really, really suggest, most underrated tip I could ever give somebody, is record your footage and watch it later. And I know some people, I've said that to them, they're like, well, what is that going to do? I know what I did. I just played the game. Why do I need to watch it again? Trust me. Watch it again, and you will just, yeah. You'll be criticizing yourself. You're smarter than you think you are.
So helpful.
You'll be watching and be like, why did I push? Why did I do that? There were three of them there. I knew they were watching the door. Why did I run in or something? Or like, oh, I went left there when there was a guy on the radar to the right. That was probably an easy kill. What was I thinking?
Yeah.
A lot of people are like, oh, well, I don't have a capture card. And that's okay. What you should do is you should sign up for Twitch. And don't worry if nobody watches you. That's totally fine. Twitch has a feature where after you stream, and you can stream right from your console too. Right after you do it, you can go to your Twitch page and you can save the broadcast. And that is a really nifty way, if you don't have a capture card, to watch your footage and then just see, what did I do? What did I do right? What did I do wrong? Okay. There's part one of the question. Part two, what do people focus on that they shouldn't?
Or a shortcut. You actually kind of mentioned that in your first answer. People want to take shortcuts. Is there a shortcut you see people take consistently that usually doesn't help them improve?
Mm. How about this? How about I give a personal no-no that I see a lot of people do? And this is something that I preach about a lot. Good Lord, I can babble about this all day. Now, before I get into this, I'm going to say there's, in my opinion, there's two ways to play Destiny or any video game multiplayer wise. There's play for fun and there's play to win.
Yeah.
And sometimes they're the same thing, but most of the time they're fairly separate from one another. And there's nothing wrong with either. I know a lot of people on both sides of the fence. I'm friends with a lot of people who are like, I can't believe what a dick playing with a matador is. Jerk with that top tier shotgun. And then I have other people who are like, why would you play with the auto rifle? Like, what are you thinking? Like, why are you so if you're playing to win, this is what you need. You have to open your mind, and this is a very difficult concept for a lot of people, and I used to be like this. Seriously, there's a book that I could really recommend every time I go on a podcast. God damn it, every time I go on, I mention this book. It's called Playing to Win by, I think the author's name is David Serlin. Can't remember if that's the exact author's name. Google it. He's a former competitive Street Fighter player. And it's a fantastic book. And a lot of things that I see people doing, it's holding themselves back. They'll say things like, here, if you're listening at home, think about if you ever had a friend who has said something like this. Oh God, I would never use blank gun. That gun is so goddamn cheesy, or that gun is so stupid. I would never use this subclass because that subclass takes no skill. If you know somebody who talks like that, you have to help them. You have to open their mind. Because if they want to win, like if they want to play for fun, that's fine. If you want to play a Titan because you freaking love defenders or whatever, then you play with the void until the cows come home. But if your friend really wants to succeed, maybe they've never been to the lighthouse before, and they really want to get there. Like, oh, I just want to get to the lighthouse. Oh, but I don't want to use shotguns. People who use shotguns are no skill scrubs. You have to open your mind. If you're putting restrictions on yourself, you're hurting your chances of succeeding. Now, I'm not saying that it's impossible to succeed in this game using weapons outside of the top meta options. That's totally not true. There are fantastic people in this community who've gone to the lighthouse with fusion rifles, sidearms, you know, primaries only, tons of stuff. But you have to think about it like it's a card game, like it's a poker game or something like that. It's you versus the other team. Think of it like blackjack or poker. Like, you have a percentage of how likely your hand is to win. Now, what if I told you I could help you increase your percent chance of winning if I just slipped an ace right into your deck? But it's not cheating. It's a free ace on the table. That it's like, then even the dealer's like, yeah, you can totally take this ace if you want. But there are some people who are too proud. They don't want to. Does that make sense? Like, they just don't want to because they put restrictions on themselves. And if you're really playing to improve and you're playing to win, there's no shame at all in using the meta. Look at all the tournament winning teams and players in this game. They understand the best options on paper. And even if you think, just for example, that the shotgun is a no-skill weapon, go play against a really good team and use a shotgun. they'll probably still beat you with sidearms. And the snipers in this game definitely take more skill to use than the shotgun. The shotgun is it's a very effective weapon that takes less work to use successfully. But that's a good thing in a way. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You're trying to maximize your chances of winning. You should have every option laid out on the table. If your goal is to win or improve or whatever, you have to consider everything. And you have to throw away those personal feelings of like, ew, warlocks or whatever.
I would say the way I've always looked at shotguns in particular, I know this question was much broader than that, but
sure.
It just made me think of something that I've always thought of shotguns, that the actual using the shotgun is fairly easy. I don't want to say no skill, but getting to the point where you can use that shotgun is very difficult, like physically. You know, sure. If I'm standing next to a guy, yeah, it's super easy to pull the trigger and kill him. But to get there, you know, that's where
there's
the
a
shotguns
lot of,
are harder.
Yeah. I actually had a friend who I convinced him of that. He was like, shotgunner, like snipers take more skill. And I was just saying, you know, snipers take more skill in my opinion. Yeah, they definitely do. But our goal in this game, buddy, is not to impress the other team.
Yeah,
with how
I love
much
that.
Skill we have. The goal is to win the game. It's as long as we have the W on the scoreboard at the end. Why do you care what takes more skill? Like, this isn't, we're not trying to impress them. We're not asking them out on a date or something like that. So I got him, he's like, okay, fine. So he starts using a shotgun. He's like, Jesus, this is really hard. I'm like, oh. Yeah, I mean, this is before shotguns turned into the mod. But even with shotguns being monsters that they are right now, it's still hard to use effectively because you have really good players out there who can stick you, they can team shoot you, they can three-tap you with a Luna or a Palindrome, they can do any number of things to ruin your day. If you think there's something out there that is OP or just too strong and you complain about it, my best advice to you is to play with whatever it is that you think that is, that's too strong. Like when I had a bunch of people telling me, oh, dude, Juggernaut is OP. It's literally impossible to beat Juggernaut. I'm like, oh, it's impossible? Okay. Go win 10 matches in a row with Juggernaut. They're like, dude, I can't do it. You'll find the chinks in the armor of what the weaknesses are of what you think is very strong.
Yeah.
And that's not to say that there aren't certain things in the game that are stronger than others, but there's nothing that's unbeatable.
Yeah.
Truly unbeatable.
For real. Yeah, and I want to talk about this all night, honestly. This is, like, my favorite thing to talk about. But and we are going to a little bit later, because I do want to talk about adaptability more and playing to win and all of that and just discussing it a little bit. But before we get into a full-fledged conversation about it, because it's because I was the other way, too, and I know even in Resolute we have, like, a lot of people who have varying opinions about it. But for me personally, I went from feeling guilty about using certain weapons to like kind of having my mind open, like, oh, I can use this weapon and not, like you talked about fear earlier, you know, and I want to talk about that a little bit, just in a different way maybe. But before we do that, let's get a little lighthearted for a second and answer some Twitter questions if that's okay with you guys.
Nice. Yeah, I'm all about that.
Awesome.
I love Twitter questions.
Let's
favorite.
Do it.
Because it's Hove's segment.
Because they're fun. All right. So we'll start off with, it was actually the first one asked, but it's a big one. This one is from Pope Bear.
Oh boy.
He wants to know if the Destiny Community Podcast versus Planet Destiny Podcast Showdown has given you any trouble sleeping.
Oh my God.
And he would also like to point out if it hasn't, it should.
Oh, Pope, I'm going to dab on you so hard, my brother.
We should point out that this conversation lasted much more than one tweet.
Oh, God, it lasted for so long. And then Pope is throwing shade at me, like, oh, look at Fallout trash talking. I was like, bro, you started it.
Yeah.
I should say.
I would say, God love him. We love Pope, but, man,
yeah.
he talks a lot of shit. All in fun.
He talks mad big game. So for those of you who don't know what the hell we're talking about, there's an upcoming event between the Destiny Community Podcast and the Planet Destiny Podcast. We're going to do a little bit of a fun throwdown, and we're going to trash talk each other on Twitter. It's all in good fun. We love those people. And it's just, they're so wonderful. And they've done this before in the past, and it's just a big deal. And there are actually some things that are in the works. I actually don't know if I can talk about them, about what we're planning for the... Oh, well, Pope told me to say... But yeah, stay tuned. There's a lot of fun stuff coming up for the Throwdown event. It's going to be great. We're going to have an awesome time. You should totally check it out. And I'll let you know when we have more information on that.
We're excited about it, yeah.
And just to be fair, I think Pope was just in that kind of mood that day. Because then all I said back was, podcast showdown, you say? Just asking. Yeah. And he goes, yeah, it's safe to book you guys too, since I'm already certain of who's going to win.
I know.
And then tagged Briar. So I was like, what?
For drama. He loves to drum the drama. It's okay. He's a great guy.
He is.
I'll let it
go. Yes.
All right. We got a good one. This one's from Rezo Spongy, who always manages to ask good questions. And Fallout, you already saw this one. I hope you were thinking about it.
Oh, okay.
You have a $10 limit. What's your go-to gas station snack?
Oh, Jesus. That was a great question.
It's so difficult.
I've been following that guy on Twitter for forever. He's a funny dude. Now, I wanted to ask him a follow-up question, but I never did. Do I have to spend all of the $10? Can I?
I would say no.
Buy...
I would say no.
Yeah. Okay.
It says limit.
It is
right?
Okay, limit.
Yeah.
I'm going to, I have to go with Funyuns. Love Funyuns.
Okay, good there's call. One.
Thinking more about this than some of the other questions.
You got about $7 left. Okay.
Yeah, right. That's an expensive bag of Funyuns, man.
You got to add tax.
Well, not the huge one. Oh, the medium bag.
All right.
Medium bag.
You got $8 left then.
And then there's the Entenmann's. What are those things? They're chocolate cupcakes, but they have the white. It's like a white lacy.
Oh, yeah.
They're laced like a football right across the top.
Yep,
you know what I mean?
Yep.
Those things are awesome. I would definitely get one of those.
We ask the hard-hitting questions.
You do.
Here,
yes.
I love Diet Mountain Dew. I love Diet Mountain Dew. That's a weird thing. People, when I say that, people are either like, dude, you are a homie for life. Or they're like, wow, you're a sick maniac. Why do you drink Diet Mountain Dew? That stuff is awesome because there's no, I'm like turning into this weird dude where I'm like, oh, I have to like watch out for sugar intake or whatever. But Diet Mountain Dew tastes awesome, and I'm pretty sure there's no sugar.
Man, I don't.
My girlfriend's making a face at me because she loves sugar. I mean, yeah, I love sugar too, but Diet Mountain, it's like you can drink as much Diet Mountain Dew as you
are
want.
Are you holding
man.
It
get
right now, Triton?
Soda, baby.
Are you holding Diet Mountain
Dew? No, this isn't Diet. Actually, I had Diet the other day come out of the vending machine by mistake, but there's definitely sugar in regular Mountain Dew, like a lot.
Oh, yeah.
As I'm looking at them, like, wow, there's really
Dude,
a lot in here.
Do yourself a favor. I know there's a lot of really nasty Diet Cola out there. You're like, oh, just F this, dude. Diet Coke is disgusting. But if you try Diet Mountain Dew, just try it. I swear to God, it tastes super good.
Interesting. I'm gonna have to at least try it. All now right. I can't like avoid it, you know. It would be something
gotta
I would never
try,
actually
man.
Try so
yeah. Oh, and can I go back in time?
Yes. Yeah,
does this gas station go back in time?
Yes.
I want 3D Doritos right now. I want the nacho cheese flavor.
Yes,
3D Doritos, that's my final answer. I want those four things from this magic gas station.
Okay, I'm gonna follow up with that then, because for me it's the salsa verde Doritos. I just love those things. I don't know what it is about.
Is that the
green
purple
bag? It's the green bag.
Oh, the green bag. Oh, I haven't had those in a while.
Yeah.
I had the purple bag though. Which one is that?
I don't know which one the purple.
It's like spicy
sweet chili something.
Sweet chili. That's what it is.
Spicy sweet.
We're
chili
close.
Yeah.
That's
like
a good flavor.
Yeah.
We're in the same family at least,
yeah.
Right there. I'm thinking like road trip mentality. Yeah. Like I'm trying to stay awake, you know.
Ooh.
Trying to keep things lively.
Yeah,
I need
totally.
Some salsa verde Doritos, the green bag. Get a little Dr. Pepper, maybe some Sour Patch Kids. Just something in that vein, you know. Stuff to like
Man.
Keep me going on the wherever I'm driving to.
Yo, do they still make Jolt?
Jolt
Cola, remember that?
No,
it was like it was this
I
old 90s it.
It
was like oh yeah we have it had double the caffeine.
Oh geez, it's like
regular
Surge
Coke. That's what Jolt was.
Something
it had, yeah, it was like this big lightning bolt on the bottle, and I used
mm-hmm.
to drink it all the time because you're a kid and you're hyper and full of sugar.
Hove Triton, what
Jolt
about you guys?
Really
I that would take me forever to even think about. There's so much. That's like my life is like gas station snack food. You got to get mini powdered sugar donuts.
That's a good
I'll put
one.
That one. Those are delicious.
Yeah.
Oh, those are good. Oh, you.
Mm-hmm.
So for the mini donuts, I like the ones with the crust. I think, dude, I spent way too much time thinking about this. The mini donuts with the crumbs on them. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Okay, yeah. Yeah.
Not
yeah,
the powdered yeah, sugar, the crumb ones. Those crumb donuts, oh, so good. Those are like tier one donuts.
That is good.
I would have to go combo because there's so many things you can get at a gas station combo. So we're talking $10.
Yeah.
You can roll a hot meal, a bag of chips, and like any drink in that store for like $4 under some of these combos. It's like 5 for $4. That's amazing. So I'd have to get like the Slurpee with every possible flavor. Because, I mean, you know, I mean, if I only have $10 anyways, might as well go big or go home. Definitely going to get any bag of chips that I want. Probably cheddar and sour cream because those are awesome. Yes. And then it's either going to be something with buffalo chicken on it because those workers are definitely going to put an excessive amount on it. So it would be extra amazing. And if it's not good and, like, not cooked right, it's okay because you're just only tasting buffalo chicken. So
that's a good
buffalo
point.
Sauce. So, and I'd have enough left over to get probably some kind of candy. So combo first. Then whatever's left over will probably be some kind of candy, whether it's like a king size Twix or one of those like Halloween king size Twix, which is like 4 of them in there or like 6 of them in there. I think that'd probably be my pick.
Triton, mad respect, bro. You home run to that answer right out of the park, buddy.
You planned out your answer as well as your questions. Like,
hey, I know.
He's like a politician. He had a speechwriter put that together for him.
I was ready for that.
Make sure you hit the Slurpee. Make sure you hit the Twix. And then look at the camera the whole time. And he's
got like I may have done that all baby today at 7-Eleven earlier on today. I may have.
You
done
gave
it
them the list,
work.
Like good you wrote man. It out, numbered, and like, sir, like, I'm going to need these things from you.
Yeah, I'm going to need these items. Triton, how do you feel about peanut butter Twix? Only because you asked, you said Twix. Ooh. How do you feel?
Well, I mean, I really do like them, so it depends. Like, but when we're talking about with this budget. I would probably... Peanut butter Twixes are never on sale, though. They're, like, never a part of your deal. Like, they're never on sale.
Do
they're
you
always
follow
way
candy
higher.
Bar sales?
Like, so, well, like the way Hope, we have talked Domino's about a lot of my... Okay, Domino's marketing plan, different than their stock. Chipotle was a different story because I like their small business unit economics, so completely different. Do I follow the parent companies of some of these candy bars?
Oh, my gosh.
There'll be
Dude.
No...
A we'll plus, buddy.
We'll
a
end it here.
For the record, peanut butter Twix is awesome. I love peanut butter.
It is awesome.
I need to try. I didn't even know that was a thing. Twix. The peanut butter. Is, no, I need.
Dude,
I need
you
got to
go
I
to
love
the store
butter.
Right now. Peanut butter Lego. Twix and a Diet Mountain Dew.
Yeah, like Lego right now. Gas station.
I'm going when this is over. I'm going down the street.
He's doing it. Then.
Go get a Nutrageous too. They're also delicious if you like peanut butter. And we're gonna move on. A little bit more of a serious question. As a known sweats player, how would I build a team if my friends are casuals or without mics and they would like to avoid just LFGs and forums?
Wow.
Ooh, well, that's kind of a really tricky question yeah. there, buddy.
Without mics, dang.
Oh, by the way, that was oh, Bot Buster. Bot, I'm sorry, yeah. I forgot that part.
Thought you were going to say, here's a hard question. Same gas station, $5.
Oh, God. No, no. They're prying.
No, but if you really want to get into sweats... I'll say this. It's very tricky. I've had many people ask me that, and it's a really limited niche in the community. It's almost this like weird underground. It's the coolest thing ever. I love doing it, but it's notoriously difficult, as has been explained to me. I can't remember because I've been doing it for a really long time, but I get asked a bunch by people who really want to get in, and that's one of the reasons why I started doing maybe like 2 or 3 times a year those intro to sweats
yeah.
events on Twitch with like people like Lupo and Ninja with Noel, yada yada, and to try and introduce people. And those events have worked really well because so many people afterwards were just like, oh dude, we played so well together, it was so much fun, hey, do you want to go into a match together, let's play more?
That's
and like
awesome.
Sweat. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome, yeah, that's really cool. But the good news is once you kind of get your foot in the door, then it becomes much easier. Like, I just have a group now, including it's my brother and a bunch of other people that I play with, and we kind of make the rounds with each other. So I usually have a lot of people to play with, but it'll take some time, and you may unfortunately need to resort to some form of LFG, but there's plenty of really good resources. There's some subreddits where they only focus on LFG, and there are, I think there's actually a subreddit too, which is just Crucible LFG, which is
that
pretty
is cool.
And there's a whole bunch of other websites. So you may have to use LFG. I'm really sorry about that. But get into it, meet some people, make some friends. The sweaty community is tremendously nice, despite what rumors on the internet might tell you. And keep at it. And I promise you that once you start, it's a snowball effect. You know what I mean? You meet some people, because everybody has people that they sweat with. And then it turns into this weird game of telephone or whatever. And you just meet more people, and it's great. So do your best to get your foot in the door. You may need to resort to LFG, but keep at it. And I promise you it'll get easier.
Yeah, I feel like Twitch streams, like you were saying, is like a great way to get into that. Like just in your own intro to sweats that you do, but even just hanging out in Twitch chat. So like I see people connecting all the time.
Totally.
Like just like, oh, hey, you're on right now, but you're not with the guy, right? You're not hanging out with anybody. Does anybody, like just somebody puts a blanket statement out there. Somebody want to go sweat right now, or someone want to go do this activity, and just doing more of that kind of stuff. Just jumping in, you know, getting to know a few people is just a great way to jump in somewhere without
it really
directly
is.
Going to an LFG.
Some people are kind of touchy about that. They're like, ah, don't use my Twitch chat to like advertise or like to do weird things. Just like chill out and watch or something. But I encourage you, like, if you want to come into my Twitch chat and ask if anyone wants to sweat, go for it. I mean, seriously, more power to you. It's another way to meet people. So
yeah,
who cares?
Yeah, I think Twitch chat's a cool way to kind of meet people. And there's been times where I've had, especially when I was just starting out, you know, maybe 6-7 people in chat, and all of a sudden I realize that no one's talking anymore. And then I look at the conversation and I realize it's because all of them were like, oh, I'm doing this. Do you want to jump in? Sure. Now we have three. Yeah, three, right. Want to play?
I'll play with
and my chat. Entire chat's playing together that's and funny. Not talking, which is fine.
Yeah,
it's great.
Totally, sure.
But it's just, oh, well, that's where everybody went. All right. Anything else anyone wants to add to that one, Triton? Any profound statements?
I don't sweat, so I don't really know what you mean.
I thought you weren't even going to say no. I thought you were just going to shake your head. All right, here's one from Drop Bear King at LaughingMan911.
Oh, my God. This is going to be a beard-related question.
How does it feel to know that there are 13-year-olds going through puberty that can grow a better beard?
Well, here's the thing.
Don't worry. This is about...
I
just look like a hobo.
Real quick, because I cannot grow a beard for the life of me. Like, I grow facial hair really fast, but it's like there's this one spot on my face that doesn't want to grow any hair. So if I did grow it out, it would look so bizarre, you know, because there's just this one patch on each side that will not grow any
it's
facial
so
hair.
So patchy. I can't, dude. I can't grow facial. And the only reason I knew that question was coming, that dude follows me on Twitch. So I knew it was coming. But...
See, I just kind of assumed that was like an inside thing. I was like, nobody would ask and not be
funny.
Like, okay with it.
Well, usually, I think it originated from when we took over the Planet Destiny podcast, because Holtzman and the crew, they went on to do their own DCP show, which is a fantastic show. And we got brought on to do the Planet Destiny podcast, which is like the coolest thing ever. And a lot of people were just like, well, we're going from a really strong beard game to a weak beard game. Because like that was just, look, you got Holtzman, you got Pope, you got Teft. They got these glorious beards, man. It's
but doesn't Mega just like completely like fill a gap there? You know what I mean?
Mega's got a really insane beard, but it was just this goofy little joke that came out of nowhere, and we kept riding it because I got to be honest, it's really funny, and I can't, man. If I grow up, one year I did No Shave November. I did November, or what is it?
November
for my office because we were raising money for prostate cancer, and I wanted to help out. I think it's a good cause, and God, it was horrific. Absolutely horrific. I do this thing which I've nicknamed my body as this thing. It's I've called it the reverse Hitler.
Oh no.
Because you know how Hitler had the weird little toothbrush mustache right in the middle? It's the exact opposite.
It's on the sides.
Me. It only forms on the sides and there's nothing in the middle. And I was like, oh, this is fucking gross, dude. I was like, never again. I no facial hair. I'll be babyface fallout. Forever.
Mine's probably like that, but it's like, you know, where you do have facial hair, that's the gap in mine, you know?
Oh my God. And it's not even cool. It's not even like the guy from, what was his name, from Kill Bill, the legendary, he taught Uma Thurman how to Pai Mei?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, you know how Pai Mei, he has kind of like that, but on the sides, nothing in the middle, but his is cool. It goes all the way down. Mm-hmm. Like that ledge. Mine looks like a middle schooler who's just like, yeah, dude, I'm not shaving because I got the hair coming out. It's
not
horrific.
Quite the crucible Pai Mei.
See, I got a little bit of all of those mixed. I got like right here, just nothing grows.
But, dude, that's respectable,
but
man.
But even in here, it's like if I let it grow, it'll get longer and longer, and it would be like a normal beard if it wasn't like a quarter as populated as it should be. So it just looks like all these little straggly hairs coming off of it.
So. Hey, dude, that looks good, man. I would be down on my knees getting the facial hair lord for that, buddy. Dude, rock that with pride, man.
Not till the time I was standing out. I hadn't shaved in a while. I was standing outside my job in a shirt and tie, but I had a hoodie on. And some guy came over and offered me change. And
oh,
I was
like,
excuse me?
My
he was
God.
Like, do you need change? And I was like, no, I don't. And he was like, oh, and just like walked away. And I was like, oh.
Well, because you brought it up, I mean, I'll take it anyway.
Yeah. Oh, man. Ooh, 30 cents. Now my limit's $10.30 at the gas station.
Exactly. Yeah. Thanks.
I can get that upsize on my Slurpee.
Oh, my gosh.
All right, another one from Spongy. This is okay. A little bit, well, normally it'd be a quick answer, but I know how we are. We're going to talk about it nonsensically for a while. Would you rather have no elbows or no kneecaps?
Oh, Jesus, I did see him ask that question. I was like, what the fuck?
I'm just going to go with kneecaps because I just feel like I don't know what would be going on down there. I don't know exactly how it would work, but I just feel like I use my hands more for stuff in general. So,
yeah.
I'm with that, yeah.
I would think that, too. Because if I had no elbows, I'd be playing video games with my controller, like, way out. That's tiring, man. No, I gotta have the elbows.
I feel like just Fallout's frustrated right now because he can't understand the science behind it, and he wants to do the math on which one would be better.
Which is the more optimal choice on paper? Yeah, I'm going with kneecaps.
I'm with both of you guys. Here. Triton, you going to complete the circle here?
No, I'm going to go with kneecaps and no, not the elbows. Well, I feel like in terms of...
Well, you already have no thumbs.
Either way, your quality of life changes quickly because of the assumption that, like, this is something we go to quickly. So it's like, well, all of a sudden I have no elbows. So I feel like if I didn't have kneecaps, that... I'd already be not great with a reduced quality of life, and then not being able to like work out or anything, I'd probably lower my life expectancy pretty quick. So I feel like if I didn't have kneecaps, I would rather have the ability to potentially exercise in some fashion.
You know you're on a gaming podcast, right?
Well, I do know that, but I'm just saying like, well, I mean, so we're on a gaming podcast. It'd be harder for me to get up and go get Mountain Dew or Twix to eat while I'm gaming.
It'd be really hard to drink that Mountain Dew that when your arm's out here all the time.
Oh my god, eating would be a nightmare.
Yeah, you could have a straw. Oh,
dude, I just realized how much of a nightmare eating would be. You can't eat. How would you do it? With no elbows, you'd have to hold it. Dude, no, screw that. Oh my god, no. Definitely need elbows.
We call my mother-in-law scissor legs because she'll walk around like moving her legs so fast, like getting stuff done. And I immediately thought of that just now whenever Fallout was doing his no elbow thing. I was like, so we would all be scissor legging around and Triton would be, I don't know what that is with no elbows, but it's funky.
I guess he'd be like some kind of mummy or zombie or they'd be at your side. I don't
know. Good question.
Okay, we've talked about this enough. Let's get out of here.
One more serious one here that will kind of lead into a little bit of Destiny talk to finish things up. Little Snack, that's just a smiley face is their name. What do you think about Destiny in 2017?
Very
broad.
I
guess just what are your thoughts on the rest of this year? Take that however you like.
I'm really looking forward to Destiny 2, which I think we will be hearing a lot about further we get into 2017. I am so excited because I think the game is so huge now to the point where we're gonna have like double the family size, because when Destiny 2 comes out, there's so many new people who are gonna come in. I think that's so fantastic. I think of all the future people, like who are the future Dattos gonna be, who are the future tournament winners gonna be, who are the future, like, because there's community members out there right now for Destiny 2, but they don't know it yet, and I think that's so cool. And in the meantime, I'm gonna keep rocking Destiny in 2017. Of course, I know a lot of people are relatively frustrated with the state of the game right now, but that's to be expected, unfortunately, just because how fresh can you keep a game that is now going into year 3? I think it's really impressive that we're playing a game in year 3 and we're devoted to it. God. Like we have podcasts and we have clans and we have Twitch streamers, and we're still like one of the top 10 games in the Twitch directory.
It's crazy.
And as far as I can tell, it's always been the top console only game that I see up there.
Yeah, totally. It's just a fantastic game. And a lot of people really frustrated that, you know, the Dawning didn't have a weapon tuning patch or something, and they're tired of the current meta, you know, don't really like hand cannons anymore, or whatever it is they say.
Right.
And I understand the frustrations. If you're looking for a new mix up in the meta, I think Bungie's gonna maybe do a little bit of weapon tweaking probably soon. But it might not be huge. You just have to realize that they're probably working really hard behind the curtain on Destiny 2. And I think they still are going to do a great job keeping the game updated until we get that sequel. So, listen, my advice to, if you love the game, keep playing it, because it's great and we love to have you here. But if you're really getting to the point with Destiny where, like, maybe you're frustrated and you're just like, oh God, I'm just burnt out, man, take a break. Well, I've had a lot of friends take, you know, just take a month off, take a week off, take whatever you like. And then they come back and they're like, oh, I had a really good time. I played, like, The Witcher, and I banged a lot of chicks, or whatever you do in The Witcher. I don't know. But yeah, take a break, because the game's going to be here when you get back. We're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
And you might come back to the game with fresh eyes, with a new purpose, or new burning fire in your heart, something like that. But if you still love the game like I do, just keep playing, man. It's going to be awesome. 2017 is going to be a great year for Destiny.
I totally agree. I think that, like, for me, 2017 Destiny is, like, I'm looking forward to what happens with the current game, like, just as far, because I know the, you know, they've said before they like it when the weapons, you know, even go through certain seasons and stuff like that.
Seasons,
and I'm,
right?
Yeah, I'm excited for whatever season comes next, you know, or if, you know, they do make little tweaks here and there, or whatever they do with the live team, you know, I'm still excited for those things. And like you were saying about, you know, if it feels like you're not really feeling it at the moment or getting too salty about things, like taking a break and going and playing another game, which I just kind of did for a week, playing Battlefield 1 and Titanfall 2, and then coming back and playing a game of Trials. It, like, felt so incredible to come back to that, to a something that I didn't have in those other games. And I can't tell you how many times that I've been playing with someone who had taken multiple weeks off, and they come back to just do one run of Trials, and they're just like, oh yeah, I'll just do it, you know. And I just tell them straight up, I'm like, hey, no pressure, man. You've been off for a while. Like, let's just have fun. Like, we play to win still and communicate and stuff, but, you know, I'm not going to get on to you for anything, you know. And we just do the run, and they have so much fun. And they're like, man, that was awesome. And I'm like, yeah, you know, it's cool to have fun, you know. Like, it doesn't have to be like this salty experience, you know.
It's cool to have fun, quote by Lego.
It's going
Lego
on a
t-shirt. 2017.
Put that on a motivational poster. Yeah. And yeah, it's cool to have
hashtag
fun.
Podcast boss.
Well, I think one of the things, hashtag podcast boss everywhere. But I think it's one of the things people need, I don't want to say need to realize, because that makes it sound like they're wrong. But, you know, a lot of it's playing with friends. You know, not all the time do I want to play Skirmish right now. But if I have three friends, you know, we're going to go play. And it's more about having fun with the friends and the community and everyone that's been built up. Which actually brings me into another thing with 2017 that'll be awesome, is GuardianCon this year. Which is another awesome community-focused event that we still have to look forward to this year as well.
I am so hyped.
Yeah, I'm super excited for GuardianCon. It'll be Hove went last year, but me and Triton didn't go, and so we're super pumped.
Oh,
yeah,
guys,
we're super pumped to have the whole cast go. And there's so many other people too that I know that weren't able to go from the community that are planning on going this year. So it's gonna be, especially because at this point it's the people who really love the game or love the community, you know, even if there are people who aren't playing that much anymore, they just love the community. So I think it's just gonna be such a hype experience, you know.
That was one of my favorite moments of being involved in this community, was going to, last year it was called Destiny Con. Now it's called Destiny Con. But it was so much fun.
It was great.
Like, God, I just got to meet so many cool people, and everyone was so nice, and the venue was cool, and oh my gosh, it was just so good. Like, because you have a lot of friends in this game.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I have no problem if I were talking to someone and be like, oh yeah, I'm playing with a really good, or like, there's a really good friend of mine and he lives in Texas. It's like, well, when's the last time you hung out with him? Well, I never hung out with him because he's an online friend, but there's no shame. I mean, like, because you make really good friends with people playing this game. And there were so many people who I was so hyped to meet. And when I got to Florida, I was like, dude, so cool to find. Yeah, right. Let's get a beer. Let's talk. Let's chill. It was just, it was fantastic. I am probably going to book my plane ticket this week already for Guardian Con this summer, because I'm ready, man. I'm so good. I'm so down to party and to see everybody.
That makes me think of something that, you know, you said finally getting to meet people that you've seen in the game and everything else. And you probably don't remember this.
Oh, yes.
We met briefly last year.
I was I was like, dude, I totally.
Yeah.
Dude.
Because we were at the after party, and I was shit-faced. And I'm just standing at the bar, and I, like, look over. And I didn't say, like, hi. Yep. I was like, you're Fallout. You're like, yeah.
I remember
I am the exact moment.
I remember exactly. It was the bar where it was... the whole thing was like a huge rectangle, and then there was an outside area
off to the right,
with like off to the right with a patio, and the bar was like this huge thing. It was like this big island in the center, this gigantic rectangle, and you had to walk all around the bar. And I had actually gone in because I was going to buy, who was I buying a drink for? I was buying a drink for, I think, for Farcog, the PvP tournament organizer, because we'd been hanging out all night. And you were 100% correct, Hope. I walked right up, and you just turned, and you went, are you Fallout Plays? I was like, yep.
Yes.
And you just said,
like, oh, hi.
You just said, what are you drinking? So I said, you were like, what are you drinking? I was like, Jack and Coke. You're just like, Jack and Coke. I was like, dude, you are awesome. And then we chatted for like 5 minutes. And I was like, dude, it's super cool to meet you. And then I was like, I got to get this drink back to my friend. And I'm so glad that.
Oh yeah, it came up like when we first talked about having you on. I was like, yeah, I met him. I was like, I was just drunk, and I just looked at him and went, "You're Fallout."
Remember the exact moment?
The way you explained it. Yes, I am Fallout. The way you explained it is so funny. Just like sitting there, and you're Fallout. Yes, I am.
Oh, it was so awesome, man. You just knew that you could walk up to any, because everyone was wearing the shirts. They were wearing the shirts, and you just be like, you just knew that I could strike up a conversation with this guy because he's wearing the shirt.
But the shirt is not a ticket,
people. Oh,
what
a great experience. Not a ticket. Oh, my God. Favorite meme of the whole event. Although I do feel so badly for the people who showed up and got turned away. Sad. But I mean, oh, my gosh. If you're listening to this right now, and you want to go to Destiny Con, excuse me, Guardian Con. If you want to go to Guardian Con, it's a lot of fun. I really suggest you go. It's just such a blast. And please, please buy your ticket in advance. T-shirt is not a ticket. You need an actual ticket. I don't even work for Guardian Con. I'm not with them. Just, I need the people to know.
Yeah.
Don't have your heart broken, because there are some people who drove. They're like, we drove for 6 hours. We came from Virginia or whatever. I'm like, that really sucks. But like, I don't know what you were thinking that you would get tickets day of. I rolled into the event. I kind of slept in, and I walked over across the street to the venue, and I was like, oh, my Lord. The line was...
It was, yeah.
Out the door, down the street. It was just insane. It was like you were buying tickets to a freaking Katy Perry concert or something. I don't know why I said Katy Perry. That was the first thing that popped in my head. But like, it's just, you got to get your ticket in advance. Don't roll in expecting that you can just walk in. And if you're there, please say hi to me. I love when people do that.
He's very nice, even if you awkwardly just tell him what his name is.
You can be drunk. It doesn't matter.
You don't even have to. We don't have to be drunk. You don't have to buy me a Jack and Coke. But there were some people who just walked up, and they were like, oh, dude, like, are you Fallout? Can like, I get a picture? You're like, you want to talk about Destiny? I was like, yeah, let's do all those things. But then there were these other times where like I look over, and there's like someone looking at me, and then like they look away when I look over, and I'm like, okay. And then like I look back, and I look back, and they look at me again. I'm like, dude, just come over. Like, let's just chill, man. I'm not gonna wrestle you, or like, what do you think?
Yes, and I think I can speak for all the Resolute members too. If you see someone wearing a Resolute shirt, like, come up and talk to us. Like, we would love to talk with you. Sure. Same exact thing, because I don't want to get weird looks and not sure if that person really wants to talk to me, if they're just being introverted and want to be left alone. So,
Or if you see the one and only RezoCast shirt in existence.
But yeah, people are not, just be nice when you walk up to them. I mean, just don't be a jerk. But I didn't meet any jerks at Destiny.
Nah, everybody was
not
super
really
cool.
Worried about it. Everyone was really chill.
Triton, we haven't forgotten about you. What about you for 2017?
Yeah, I think Guardian Con is probably the thing I'm looking forward to most, other than, you know, if we do get Destiny 2 at the end of the year, obviously. So, yeah.
A man of few words, but his words are strong.
They're solid.
This is true. That's become his thing.
Well, I think that's it for Twitter questions, right?
Yep.
All right. Well, I do want to talk about the play to win thing we were talking about earlier. But before I even jump into that, I just remembered SRL was a pretty big deal to you last year, and the Dawning just ended just this week. So I'm curious, how did you fare this week? Did you beat your girlfriend's time?
I'm really glad you brought that up. So, oh my gosh, last year I was so addicted to SRL, and I was so hyping it up, and I raced so hard when the Dawning dropped, like hours, and then the next day I would come home literally right after work, just take off my coat, sit down, grind, race, and I did that for a couple days, and then I burned so hard. I couldn't, like, I was going to bed and I leaned over to my girlfriend and I was like, my hands hurt, like, I have to get up and I have to ice my hands because they're like frozen into this claw, like, it just hurt to move all my fingers, and I was like, I gotta just chill with the race.
I saw you tweeting out, like, you were like, how do y'all hold the controller, because my hands cannot take it anymore.
I had a blast doing it. I didn't beat my ultimate fast time on Venus because, again, I chilled. I'm really glad, because I knew going in that they were going to add it to custom games. So if I really want to, I can go in whenever I want to race and try to beat my time. So I was like, oh, thank God, I don't need to sit in this chair and live here for like 2 weeks straight trying to beat that score. Because I would have done that if they hadn't added SRL to custom matches. But I did pretty well. I beat basically all of my friends' best times, which is
nice. So, well,
bragging rights, since
you're here too, right? and the Dawning just ended, I just want to ask, just, you know, your general opinion, how did you feel about the Dawning event overall, now that it's over, looking back? You know,
I thought it was fun. I'm kind of slapping myself on the wrist a little bit that I didn't get more involved with everything that Bungie added to offer. I didn't really try to grind for the icebreaker. I didn't really dive too deeply into the strikes or anything like that. I just really, really enjoyed SRL and just wandering around in the tower and listening to that really, really hype music. And I thought the new armor I thought was super awesome. Cool. My girlfriend has the full Titan set. It's so awesome looking, dude. Jesus Christ. But I was doing my typical boring Fallout grind the PvP stuff with my friends.
That's good, though, because the tower really was the main thing. Everything else you can pretty much, you know, go back and do again. Like the icebreaker and all the gear from Zavala, like that all is still here. So, which is something I'm enjoying, too, because that gold Titan armor, that's like what I've been grinding for, because it looks so cool. And I still have the helmet left, and so I'm almost there. But it sounds like you played your cards right, just enjoying the tower for what it was.
And people didn't really hate on it too much. I mean, a lot of people really hated on Festival of the Lost in the things that they thought Bungie could have done better, and they kind of screwed the pooch on. So the fact that I think a lot of people really responded positively to the Dawning, I think that kind of speaks as to that it was a pretty good event. I've heard a lot of people say
totally
they really enjoyed it. So good
totally
job.
Agree.
Yeah, I thought they made a lot of improvements from Festival of the Lost. I thought it was really good.
Good.
That was very good. I thought it was good.
I thought it was good.
Well, I also want to jump into what we were talking about earlier with the play to win and that mindset, because for me, that was like a huge eye-opener because I really did feel guilty as far as what weapons I were using. And I know that there's people in Resolute and around in the community that will still feel like, oh, you just shouldn't use that gun, you know, and they have their reasons for that. But for me to just hear, I don't know, I think it was just listening to a podcast, and it was either you or like Bones or one of those guys were just like, hey, like, you know, like if you're wanting to win, use what's best. Like you don't, you know, like the example you gave earlier was perfect. And like, I just feel like, yes, I why am I handicapping myself by not doing that? And I feel like I didn't go 100% into where it's like, okay, this particular loadout or this subclass with this shotgun or whatever is the complete way. But I found what was fun for me, which is fusion rifles and being a Titan, and what was effective for me to win and playing that way with whatever guns I needed. And if I want to switch it up and, like, you know, for whoever I'm playing against, I can do that and not feel salty about whatever I need to switch to. As long as I'm having fun doing it, I don't need to feel guilty for those things. So is there any tips, I was wondering for you, Fallout, is there any tips you can give as far as someone who's in that mindset who feels like, I just can't ever see myself using this gun because the community hates it? Like, is there any advice you can give that person who says, like, I don't know if I could ever use that gun. You know, how do I change my mindset?
It's like when you were young and in school and your mother told you you shouldn't care what other people think of you. Like, if you, it's a really terrible comparison. Like, let's say you get a bad haircut or something. Like, well, what is everyone gonna, like, who cares? What do you care what people, like, what's the difference? Like,
right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, every blue moon, and it doesn't even happen that often. Like, every blue moon, someone will message me like, bro, how about you try putting the Luna away and, like, getting a kill? And I'm like, for the record, I really, really enjoy when people trash talk me. It's so rare, because normally I get messages, they're like, oh dude, it's you, like, you're so cool. I'm like, uh-huh. Oh, I love you, thanks for reaching out. And then, like, someone will send me a salty trash talk message, I'm like, oh yes, someone's, like, salty. And I, because, like, some people, I don't argue, I'm just like, well, why would I do that? Like, why would I put away the Luna if it's the best primary that I have? He's like, well, because it doesn't take any skill. It's like, well, I'm not trying to show off my skill to you. I'm trying to beat you. So why would I not use what's good?
Yes, that analogy and then, right there is so good.
And then they're just like, and, like, they just, sometimes they don't respond. I've actually had, in the history, I've had one person who I've converted via a trash talk message. We messaged each other for, like, 2 days. And he was like, you know what? He's like, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. I was being a douche. It's like, I'm gonna try. Like, whatever the meta was. This was so long ago. He's like, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna use whatever. And then he was like, dude, this gun's awesome. I was like, yeah, man, let's go. But so just, it's usually Destiny PvP. If you're playing to win, it's a competition. Think of a really tall basketball player. Okay, think of a really tall basketball player. Now, what takes more skill for a very tall basketball player to do? Does it take more skill for him to sink a three, or does it take more skill for him to just dunk over a guy who he has a full head and a half advantage over? Well, it's going to take more skill to drain the three. Sure, no argument there. It's really hard to do. But if he's the tallest guy on the court and he's really good at jamming it to the hole, and the other team is short and he's really trying to win, why would he not do that? Like, you wouldn't hear anyone in the NBA back when Shaq was still in the game. No one would send Shaq a salty post-game sticky note. I don't know. I'd be like, bro, all you do is dunk. It takes no skill. He'd be like, well, yeah, I guess you're right, but we beat you by like 30 and I covered the spread. Yeah. So get bodied.
The Crucible, like, is no place for mercy. Like, am I right? Like,
yeah, who cares?
And also what you were saying before too about, but let's see, like, going and playing with the weapon that you think is, you know, so much better, or, you know, that doesn't take any skill, you know, it's like, go and use that weapon then and see, like, how much skill it takes and see what its weaknesses are so you can play against it, you know? Like, I've definitely had moments like that playing with the weapon that I want to play with, you know, that is fun for me. You know, and then maybe I'm getting frustrated by a juggernaut, and I, like, so I reverse it and go play with the juggernaut for a little while, figure out what its weaknesses are, and then go back and try doing what I was doing before and try to counter it, you know, or something like that. If not, then I adapt to it and I think it's fun and I use that all the time because I'm winning using it. So either way, it's a win.
There you go. Yeah, totally.
Right.
Well, before we end the podcast, I would like to ask Fallout, do you, you know, I know that you are a big fan of adaptability and working within the current state of the Crucible, but I'm curious, you know, if you could dream, and with whatever the live team brings us next, you know, what would you like to change in the or maybe not even change in the Crucible, but like just as far as Destiny in the future, is there anything that you would be looking forward to? It might not even be Crucible related. Maybe it's like quality of life stuff or something like this. Is there anything that you dream about for Destiny?
Bungie, please let me delete items from the Postmaster without having to take them out of the Postmaster. Please. I will do anything you want if you add that to the game. Please, I'm fucking begging you.
That's a good one. I've never...
Oh my God.
I just want to be able to move it with Destiny Item Manager, you know, out of there as soon as it goes over there.
Yeah, that'd be great too. I don't want it. It's a blue... What am I going to do with a blue primary engram, man? Just keep it. I don't want it. Do whatever you do with the robot parts, buddy. Like, I don't want it.
What's awesome is they're listening to a lot of the feedback we've given like that with the green engrams, you know? And it's like, man, they're making those improvements. That's what makes 2017 exciting for me is with everything that the Dawning that brought, that they were listening to us and like, you know, constantly seeing what are these quality of life things that can make this game better. Because everybody, you know, always talks about Destiny Year One, you know, how great things were looking back on it, in particular talking about weapon balance stuff. But like thinking about Destiny Year One for me is like I look at the vault space we had back then and I'm like, no, I couldn't go back to just those 20 spots. Like it would be impossible.
And I really shouldn't be bringing this up this close to the end of the show, but because it always turns into, I'll try and keep it as short as but I really would love if they would bring back some form of weapon reforging. And I know so many people disagree with me when I say that, but a lot of people really, really care about the weapon reforging. And I understand the complaints against it because it's like, oh, well, it makes the game more bland because everybody just rolls the guns for the exact same completely optimal perks. My answer to that is, well, that is a little stale, but it's kind of the game designer's job to make sure that there are many, many perks that are desirable in the game. And if there's only like two that we're really rolling for, maybe we should look at those other perks. Don't hate the player, hate the game. But but I understand that people would be going for the same roles and you'd see a lot of the same weapons in Crucible and it makes the game more quote bland depending on how you look at it. But it makes things more fair. And I am really a big advocate of making a level playing field for people in PvP. It's why I was such a huge fan of Halo, because everybody starts off with a battle rifle or a DMR or a pistol or whatever. And it's upsetting to me that there are some players in the game who really want to get better, but they have very realistic roadblocks, not only just to improve as a player, but because like, oh my gosh, I'm playing against these people and they have god roll guns and I haven't gotten a really good gun. I just have this bad shotgun or this bad hand cannon or whatever. And it's not that I haven't tried. I play like I'm grinding for it, but it's just the RNG is so unkind to me. And that's what I really think is kind of a shame, which I was so happy when they gave us weapon reforging because everybody was then on a very level playing field. And I thought that was really cool. So I understand the downsides, but I really think that if we had some form, doesn't have to be the exact same as House of Wolves, but if we had some form of weapon reforging to come back, I think that would be great.
Yeah, you've honestly converted me on this topic because I when it went away, I was like, thank God, because like everybody has the exact same thing, like, and I was so salty about it. But then like I started thinking about like, well, what if it was really pricey to do it? And like, you know, if you really wanted that thing, like whether it was a 50 legendary marks or something that you had to grind for throughout the week, but it was, you were working towards it, you know, every time.
That would be cool.
And I was like, man, grind. That could be great.
That would be awesome. It'd be like a new way to like work towards something that you really want to get, you know, grind out quests or get these marks and you can buy the perks that you want to get. And some perks cost more and whatever. So you still have the unique weapons or whatever, but you would just have a sense of pride, like, oh, I earned that IS Luna, I earned that gun or something like that, you know?
Then I would finally have Icarus on one of my game.
Right? Like, doesn't it make you sad that that the gun perk that you really want, and it's actually a really good gun perk too, is out of your hands due to no control of your own?
Story would finally have rifle barrels.
Yes, he would. No more casket mag for you, Story.
I had a friend DM me the last 2 days, once with a Luna she got with rifled Icarus and rangefinder, and the next day with a palindrome with rifled Icarus and hidden hand, and I wanted to throw.
Sounds like a Triton kind of move, honestly.
But no, I have already have one of those. I already have a couple of them.
Oh, shut up.
Jerk. I didn't get them in the last couple days that I've had them.
I'm not even going to go into it because, like Fallout with re-rolling, I could talk about Icarus and for days. All day.
Yeah. Okay, well, why don't we just go ahead and shut this thing down for now? We've had a great episode with Fallout. Such a good time. Thank you so much for being here, man. Like, seriously, it was great.
I love it. Thank you guys so much for having me. It's truly an honor to be your first outside guest here on the show. You guys are doing a great job, and I really look forward to meeting all of you in person at GuardianCon.
Well, we've really enjoyed having you, Fallout, and you can find me, I'm Lego, at LegoleFlash on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, everywhere. Hove, where can they find you?
All the same places, Twitter, Twitch, not really on YouTube, but it's there, at Hove76, H-O-V-7-6, Triton.
Yep, all the same places under Triton Please, the please being PLZ, and how about you, Fallout?
Look for me on YouTube and Twitch at youtube.com/falloutplays and twitch.tv/falloutplays, all one word. And then on Twitter, I'm actually Fallout_plays. So hit me up there. I'm usually tweeting back and forth with people throughout the day. So
yeah, and
don't be a stranger.
And go listen to him on Planet Destiny, too. He's doing a great job over there with the new cast of Planet Destiny. It is a good time, so be sure to check that out. You can also talk to us at RezoCast on Twitter. We'd love to hear your questions for our next guests and communicate with you just about Destiny, and we'll see you at DestinyCon 2 as well. GuardianCon. Dang it! We'll see you at GuardianCon as well. The whole cast will be there. Hove, where can they find more about Resolute?
Yeah, if you want to know more about Rezo in general, you can go to TeamResolute.com, at Twitter, at TeamResolute, or on Twitch at twitch.tv/resolutegaming7.
Awesome, guys. Well, this has been RezoCast episode 16 with Fallout. We really enjoyed having you here. Be sure to tell your friends about us on iTunes, leave a review if you like it, or on YouTube. We appreciate it. And until next time, guys, GGs.
I'm trying to think of something funny, but I can't think of it.
Don't worry about it.
I'm going to think of something, like, really funny tomorrow in the shower. I'll be like, oh, damn.
Oh, dang it.
Hey, dear. We're recording and there's a camera on.
Almost had an accident.
That's a weird thing. People, when I say that, people are either like, dude, you are a homie for life. Or they're like, wow, you're a sick maniac. Well, why do you drink?
It's funny for me.
Diet Mountain Dew.
My audio, like, went blank for a second. So it was like, I drink. And I was like, what? Oh. What?
Oh, sorry. Hold it. Dude, no, screw that. Oh, my God.
We always call.
Definitely.
We call my. Dang it. I can't think of the freaking word.
I've only seen clips of The Witcher with, like, naked chicks.
I thought that was, like two separate things. Like, I played The Witcher and I banged a lot of chicks. Like,
play The Witcher and I banged a lot of chicks. Yeah. Totally two different things. If he's the tallest guy on the court and he's really good at jamming it to the hole.
Yeah, I mean, if I was that good at jamming it in the hole, I'd do it all the time, too.
I got to learn how to choose my words better.
I thought Hope was going to say something
just now.
What we got
next? Anything
else? Go ahead.
I was going to go with the basketball thing, but I don't want this to be much longer.
Sorry. Did I just look at... Did you totally just fart while we were streaming?
Yes. I was hoping that's what was... I hope was hoping someone would notice
what
that.
What happened?
He leaned like this, and I heard the tiniest, quietest fart, and I totally lost my train of thought.
Wait, who did? Was it me?
Wait, Lego,
was it me?
Oh my god.
Like, Lego, how do you not
know
the dude?
No, I didn't even realize it actually happened. I thought, like, it looked like it.
Dude, I'm so sorry. I love it. Thank you guys so much for having me. It's truly an honor to be your first outside guest here on the show. You guys are doing a great job, and I really look forward to meeting all of you in person at Guardian Con.
Yes.
You could say you popped three cherries.
I'm going to tell everybody that in the morning.
Oh, my God.
Did you have a good night last night? Oh, you have no idea.
And one of them farted halfway through it. I didn't know what to do.
It was awesome.
And then Lego thought it was him.
I can't get over that Lego thought it was him.
I didn't think it was me. I thought, good, man. Oh, my God.